Good morning. The Prince George's County Planning Board is now in session. We do have some announcements. I'm going to hold off on the announcements for the moment, and I'm going to proceed with the actual agenda. We're going to start with item 3C, which is the maglev presentation. Ms. Martin, Ms. Hancock.
Good morning. Bradley M. Smith, the director of the Office of Freight and Multimodalism with the Maryland Department of Transportation, is here to present an overview of the Baltimore-Washington Superconducting Maglev project. So I'll turn it over to Mr. Smith.
Thank you to the board for inviting me today. I've got a quick presentation I'm going to run through, and then I'd be happy to answer any questions that the board may have. So as far as what I'm going to talk about today, I'm going to give a complete overview of the project, what work has been done so far, what work we're doing currently, and then next steps and upcoming milestones for the project itself. So first, I want to talk about the study area. So as mentioned, I'm discussing the Baltimore-Washington SC Maglev project. The project itself and the study that MDOT is overseeing extends from Washington, D.C. all the way up to Baltimore City. So it's about a 40-mile project. The study area itself in sections is about 10 miles wide and covers five different jurisdictions. So the District of Columbia, and then there's four jurisdictions in Maryland, including Prince George's, Anne Arundel, Baltimore counties, and Baltimore City are all part of the study area. And basically what that means is that the project and the alignments and alternatives that we've been considering and evaluating are going through or have gone through, and we're looking at those jurisdictions. A little bit of background about the project itself. The proposal is being advanced by a private entity called Baltimore-Washington Rapid Rail. They're proposing to build and operate the system. So traditionally, the type of projects that MDOT is involved in are like, say, State Highway or MTA, where we're building and owning the facility ourselves. In this case, we're just facilitating the review of a private entity's proposal. BWRR ultimately wants to operate the system between Washington, D.C. and New York City. This first phase of the project, which is the subject of the study that MDOT is involved in, is just the phase between Washington, D.C. and Baltimore. As part of that phase, there's three stations that are being proposed, one in Washington, D.C., one at BWI Airport, and one in Baltimore City. Overview of the players that are involved in this study. The lead federal agency is the Federal Railroad Administration. They're part of the U.S. Department of Transportation. They're providing the funding and the sign-off and approvals and providing all direction for the project and the study. Maryland Department of Transportation, the agency that I represent, is serving as the grantee for the project. So there's some federal grant funding that was provided for the project several years ago. As a private entity, BWRR is not eligible to receive that funding directly from the federal government. They needed a project sponsor. So as part of that process, MDOT is serving in that role as the grantee and facilitating the administration of the grant funding and also overseeing the planning study that's being conducted. As part of that planning study, we're coordinating with about three dozen agencies that have special expertise in certain areas and are able to evaluate potential impacts that this project may have. So we're coordinating with folks at the federal level, the state level, and the local level. So example of some of the federal agencies that we're working with are the Army Corps of Engineers and the Environmental Protection Agency. At the state level, we've got folks like Maryland Department of the Environment, Department of Planning, Maryland Historical Trust, and then at the local level, we're working with county DPWs, county park agencies to help us understand what the potential impacts of the project may be. As far as project funding, I mentioned that there's a federal grant that's funding this project. Back in 2015, Maryland applied for this federal grant to the U.S. Department of Transportation. We were awarded this grant on BWR's behalf. So the funding is $27.8 million coming from the federal government. That requires a 20% local match, which is being provided by BWR. Typically, when there's a federal project and a match requirement, the local jurisdiction, MDOT, or if it's a county, would be providing the match. In this case, the state has said that we're happy to facilitate the project, but we're not providing any direct state funding. So BWR has agreed to provide that 20% match. So with their match and the federal government grant that's been provided, there's about $35 million of a budget that we have that's overseeing the activities that have been ongoing for the last 3 years or so and will be ongoing into 2020. As far as the structure of how that grant funding is being administered, I've got an org chart here that shows Federal Railroad Administration providing the funding to MDOT, and then we're overseeing the key activities of the planning study, which are broken out into two different areas. One, the engineering and technology development, which is being done by BWRR in coordination with the Maryland Economic Development Corporation. They're on the left-hand side of that graphic there. And then on the right-hand side is the environmental review. So there's an environmental review that's being done of BWRR's proposal. It's being done independently of the work that they're doing, and that's being overseen by MDOT's Maryland Transit Administration and a consultant that we've hired to do the majority of that work for us. A little bit of background about maglev and the development and study of maglev in the United States. So about 20 years ago, Congress established the maglev deployment program with the purpose of demonstrating the feasibility of maglev technology in the United States. So for a number of years, on and off and on, maglev has been progressed and developed by the federal government with funding assistance and also studies that they've done. The last time that this was really studied in detail in the state of Maryland was back in the early 2000s. There was a study looking at the same corridor, Baltimore to Washington. That project progressed to a draft environmental impact statement, which was published in 2003, but the project was then suspended, put on hold, prior to the final environmental impact statement being completed. Since that time, BWR has been working with the Japanese. They've developed the superconducting maglev technology that's in operation in Japan right now and is being built out in a system over there. So they've partnered with them to investigate the SC maglev application in the Baltimore-Washington corridor. So the difference there is the prior study back in the early 2000s was looking at the German technology, which uses a slightly different technology. In this case, BWR is looking at the Japanese technology. And also, BWR is out in front of the project and proposing to design and operate the project themselves, whereas back earlier, there wasn't a private entity that was out front like they are in this case.
Is the Japanese system more advanced than the German one?
Yes, there's slight differences in how the system works, which I'll show in a minute, but also the speed. So the speed of the Japanese system can get up to 311 miles an hour, where the previous system was operating in the 200 mile an hour range.
And why was it suspended, the earlier study in the earlier 2000s?
So I wasn't involved in the earlier study. I don't know if it was lack of funding. I understand there was some community concerns as well, maybe funding issues as well, maybe not having a private entity out in front that had plans to actually carry the project forward after the planning study was done. Those are some of the things that I've heard. So I mentioned that we're going through an environmental review process that's dictated by the Federal National Environmental Policy Act, or NEPA. You guys may be familiar with that. As part of that process, we're conducting an environmental impact statement, which is the highest level of NEPA documentation that you can do. So that process is outlined on the right-hand side here. Shows that there's a number of activities and steps that are done over a course of several years. So we're about halfway through, maybe a little further than halfway through that process. We're working on the draft environmental impact statement, which is highlighted on the right-hand side, right in the middle there. And as part of that process, we're looking at and evaluating potential impacts to a number of environmental resources, including parks, natural environmental features, and then also some other issues like air quality, noise, traffic impacts, the impacts on residences, potential impacts on businesses. So all of that is evaluated and rolled up into this document called the Draft Environmental Impact Statement, which we'll be moving forward with and publishing later on this year. So up to this point, we've done a number of public outreach activities. We've held a series of public meetings and informational sessions throughout the study area. And the information that we've gotten through that process and through that outreach, we've refined the alternatives and the analysis, and that will all be rolled up and documented in this DEIS that's going to be coming out later this year. That will go out for public review. We'll get comments on that, and the process will be finalized next year with the final environmental impact statement and record of decision. A little bit of overview on the SC Maglev technology. So I've got a graphic here in the upper left-hand corner, kind of showing a cross-section of how traditional trains work and then also how this Maglev train works. So the left-hand side shows traditional steel wheel, steel rail system. This is like how the Amtrak train would work or how trains in Europe or commuter trains work. So you've got steel rail sitting on steel, or steel wheel sitting on steel rail. In the case of Amtrak, if it's powered by electricity, there's overhead wires that are powering the system and allowing the train to move through the use of electricity. The SC Maglev system differs in that it is powered by magnets. So you can see on that cross section, there's magnets that are installed within the train itself. And then the train sits inside of a U-shaped guideway where there's coils installed in the guideway and in the sidewalls. The interaction between the coils and the magnets allows the train to propel, and as it's propelling, it's levitating on a cushion of air within that U-shaped guideway.
So the power is from the magnets?
Yeah.
The power is from the magnets?
Correct, yeah.
Okay.
It's really cool.
Yep, and so because there isn't that friction between the steel wheel, steel rail, it's able to go much faster than the typical Amtrak commuter train. So as I mentioned earlier, this particular system is being designed to operate at up to 311 miles per hour. So what that translates into as far as a trip between Washington, D.C. and Baltimore is that you can make that trip in 15 minutes. And that includes the stop at the BWI airport. So the train itself operates in a dedicated infrastructure, dedicated alignment in two different type of sections. So one is it's either in tunnel, or the second is it's either in an elevated guideway or a viaduct, which is shown in this graphic. So in the tunnel section, there's two tracks, one going in each direction, both located within a single tunnel bore. It's got an interior diameter of about 43 feet. The tunnel itself is obviously underground. The average depth of the tunnel is between 80 and 120 feet below ground. For the areas that are in the viaduct section, or this kind of a raised bridge section, are located or shown in that center diagram there. Similar to like a highway overpass or something like that you would see. The out-to-out width for that is 46 feet, and the total right-of-way is about 72 feet. The average height of the viaduct is about 30 to 100 feet above ground. This picture here shows the viaduct section in Japan. So again, similar to like an elevated section of I-95, although it's much narrower at the 46 feet is much narrower than a section of, you know, 4, 6, 8 lane highway. So, but in that respect, it does generally look like a elevated highway. Another component of the system is fresh air and emergency egress facilities. Mm-hmm. So this is in the cases of the tunnel sections. If the facility for some reason needs to be ventilated, there's fans and a whole system in place to provide fresh air and vent the system. And then there's also emergency egress if there's an event of some sort of situation or emergency and passengers need to get off of the train and exit and get to ground level, they need a place to do that. So in the tunnel section, these are spaced about every 4.5 miles. The facility itself needs about 3 acres per site, and there's a building that's constructed that's anywhere between 2 and 4 stories high, depending on sort of how it's designed and laid out. As far as in Prince George's County, there's 2 of these facilities that would be proposed, and I've got more details about the specifics of where they're being considered on the next slide. But again, this is just for the tunnel section. So the first one that we're looking at is along Maryland 201 Kenilworth Avenue on some WSSC property. So there's a WSSC building and a large parking lot that's located off of Kenilworth Avenue. So the facility itself would be located on that parking lot. There's been coordination with WSSC and BWR as far as the exact siting of that and where that would sit on the property, but I've kind of highlighted here the current thinking as far as where that would be sited on that property. The second location is along Maryland 410 Veterans Highway, and this is in a private property section, a currently wooded section in the Martins Wood area.
On that last slide.
Go ahead.
So I understand that you're doing some of the siting with WSSC, but throughout this process, our commission has been somewhat ignored in terms of the actual selection of that location, because we have, on the left-hand panel, we have property that's right there that we've been doing a lot of environmental restoration in that area. It's a waterfront area. There's some mm-hmm. boats that we rent out, kayaks and boats. We have a parking lot right there, and it's a historic site. And just north of there is an extremely important park that has some monuments for us. But every single time I've seen them, and I'm supportive of the Maglev project, but every single time that I've seen anyone come in here and talk about it, they've just pushed aside any sort of environmental comments on that. So I don't know if you have even any updates, because these sides are fine, but these are what we've seen over and over again. And I've seen these in public presentations. And I'm just looking for more information on how you're not going to disturb the environment around there and what we've been pushing for, because there's been an enormous amount of cleanup on all that green area where those dotted red lines are going through. Just to the left-hand side of the screen, there's a lot of green area around there. Mm-hmm. We've made enormous strides with our park rangers and volunteer folks and lots of other people who've come in and tried to help restore that local environmental waterway and that watershed right in there. So I want to make sure that anything that goes into there, it's going to be really cognizant of that, and they're going to address any sort of improvements we've made and not mess it up.
Sure.
And I haven't really seen any sort of evidence that you would actually take that into consideration, besides that you've just found a place and you're just going to do it right there. Having underground tunnels right there is extremely concerning to me, because I want to make sure we don't disturb the local environment there. We're going to have potentially lots of folks coming up through DC that can take the trail that runs along the river right there on the east side of the river, and they can come up into Prince George's County. There's a lot of folks that can go down from Prince George's County to DC. So not messing that up is an extremely high priority of mine. that has been more or less ignored by everyone who's come in and actually talked about this. So I don't know if you have anything more that you can say about how that's going to be avoided, or if you can take that back and make that a priority and a comment that you take back to the folks who are working on the project.
Sure, so that's a good comment, and I'll just add, so what's not shown on here is the limit of disturbance, the LOD, so
yeah.
That shows, you know, where construction activities and all will be occurring. So we do have that for the entire corridor and all the alignments and components of the project that are being evaluated. And so what has been happening over the last couple of months is that the environmental team has been using that LOD, going out in the field and doing surveys, doing analysis to look at all the areas where there would be any kind of disturbance. And so that's all been documented, and that is being included in the DEIS. It's going to be coming out later this year as far as, you know, what areas do we expect to have disturbance of those areas. What type of resources have we found when we went out in the field? So this is wetlands, this is historic properties, this is a lot of the stuff that you were talking about. So we've sent people out, teams out, to do that evaluation and do that analysis. That's all been documented and will be included in the DEIS. So hopefully, once that comes out, that'll answer a lot of your questions.
So before that, so that wouldn't be acceptable in my view of how the process would work. We're also a state agency, just like you guys. So if this is our local expertise, this is our land, and this is what we're trying to preserve from a regional aspect that the General Assembly created us 90 plus years ago to actually do, I don't think you guys should be giving us this at the end of the year whenever this comes out publicly. You should probably be talking with our staff, making sure they get the LOD, make sure they've seen it, and make sure they can give you guys feedback, because there might be stuff that you don't realize. There might be things that you've done that's great. You've reviewed everything. We have hundreds of staff. We have 2,000 people that work for our commission. Mm-hmm. Lots of experts that look at environmental aspects, and if you don't integrate them in the process early on, you're going to get lots of pushback.
Yeah. So
if it's written, if it's documented, if it's done, share it. Don't wait to come out with the public and give it to everyone else, and then us find out, oh, this is great, but you missed X many things, or you missed some stuff that could have been done. To work in concert and to come and actually collaborate with us, that would be a really nice step to take.
Yeah, so in one of my previous slides, I showed and talked about all the agencies at the federal, state, and local level that we're coordinating with. There's about 36 agencies in total, and these are experts. So like Maryland Department of Environment, Maryland Historical Trust. So whenever we feel like we're potentially impacting a historic property or some sort of natural area, we are coordinating with them. We have monthly calls with all the agencies that are invited.
That includes Maryland National Capital.
Yeah, so I mean,
yes,
my big concern is I want to make sure that those panels right there, we are right there. Like, we are the local experts that are doing this. So I understand you have other people that you're working with. That's us right there. We own a lot of the property right around there. If you're not coordinated with us and we haven't looked at them, we haven't seen the LOD, we should. So I'm not trying to give you a hard time in terms of all the processes you should implement and come up with, but if you want to know who knows about that area, it's us. It's not anyone else that's in the other area that works for another state agency. We own the land right there. We own, literally adjacent across the street from you, a ton of parkland and wetland area. So if you haven't shared the LOD with our staff, you guys should. It's a request that I hope you'll take back and escalate before it comes out publicly and then we find out about it and we have to go through negotiations that might be too late.
Right. Just to be clear, Maryland National Capital Parks and Planning Commission staff is part of this group of agencies that I've talked about and that are on the calls and that are provided briefings. But if there's additional outreach and coordination that we need to do, I'd be happy to help facilitate that and make sure that
the LODs I would love to see. Yeah. I would love that the LODs and that stuff to be shared with our staff early on. And if it's done, like you said, now then.
Sure.
I think this would be the appropriate time to actually do that.
Yep.
Commissioner Dorner, we also want to let you know that staff did make that comment in an October 11, 2018 memo to them.
Yes.
And we also want to let you know, as Mr. Smith mentioned, we're considered one of the participating agencies in this project.
Okay, yeah, I just want to make sure that we've seen it and that we're well aware of everything. We've been able to provide comments because I feel like we just kind of keep making the same feedback.
Yeah, we haven't seen the LOD, but we did make that comment.
So that's the point he's making about not just participating, but information sharing.
Yeah, right. So I think you just heard our staff say that we're literally across the street from the site you selected. We are the local experts in this area. If you want to have actual real advice about this, you should probably share the LOD.
Sure. I can certainly take that back and make sure we're coordinating on that.
Okay.
Okay. I've got a question, just to follow up. How do they determine whether it goes underneath or goes by a viaduct? What factors are used?
So there's a couple of factors. Again, as I mentioned earlier, the system is being designed and engineered by BWRR. Mm-hmm. So they've got some design criteria that they set out at the beginning of the project, as far as they're designing and building this from the ground up. So it has the ability to operate at this very high speed. So they've got criteria as far as geometry and curves and all of that that are required in order to operate at that optimal speed. So that dictates really a lot of the alignment, where it's going. And then depending on what the features are on the surface, they've made a decision to either go in tunnel or be elevated on viaduct. So in the district and coming out of the district into Prince George's County, all within the Beltway, there's a lot, as you guys know, there's a lot of infrastructure and things that are built up in that area. So they've decided to stay completely underground to avoid surface impacts to a pretty good extent. And then once they get out to 295, which I can show on further slides, in that area around USDA, between north of Greenbelt all the way up to Fort Meade, there's not as much above ground features. So they've decided to have it elevated there. And then as they're going down to BWI Airport and into Baltimore, again, there's a lot of features on the surface, so they've decided to go in tunnel in that section.
Okay, great.
So this is a rendering that shows what the facility at Maryland 410 would look like. The upper right-hand corner is the no-build, or basically the existing condition. Shows that wooded area there on the north side of 410, and the proposed fresh air emergency egress facility is superimposed there along 410. As far as alignments, so there's a number of alignments that have been investigated between Washington, D.C. and Baltimore, and the alignment is basically just the route that the train will take between stations. And so we looked at a number of initial concept alternatives. We had as many as 14 that we considered based on public outreach, feedback from agencies, and also just the environmental analysis that we did internally and screening that we did. Over the course of several rounds of screening, we've gotten that down to just two build alternatives that are being considered. Both of them are in the Baltimore-Washington Parkway corridor. So for the above ground section, we've got an alignment that is on the east side of the parkway, and then also an alignment that is on the west side of the parkway. And I mentioned that there's three stations that are being considered: DC, BWI, and Baltimore.
So where does the viaduct begin?
So I've got that here on the next slide here.
But before you go to the next slide, I see there were consideration given to modifications as it relates to Amtrak. Talk to us a little about what's being contemplated there. So the Amtrak train will stay in place. The Acela, I guess that's their quote-unquote high speed.
Yeah, so all these lines that are shown on the map are just the 14 that we did look at and evaluate. So all but two of these, the two that have that arrow pointed to them, the purple and the kind of the mint green.
Where you're ending up, I'm asking a broader question with regards to Amtrak.
I mean,
so the project just goes forward without any, collaboration, consideration. I just would like to understand where Amtrak stands in all of this.
Yeah, so Maglev is a totally separate system serving separate stations. So Amtrak comes into DC at Union Station. This BWR is proposing to build a completely new station, not at Union Station, use their own station alignment. This is all brand new infrastructure, brand new alignment. So in that sense, there's really no interconnection, with Amtrak. It's totally new facility.
Okay.
Correct.
All right. And do you know where they're contemplating it, the build out in DC as a starting point, or just thinking about it?
Yes. So I don't have a detailed zoom in this presentation, but they're looking along New York Avenue. So the alignment would come in along New York Avenue. New York Avenue is oriented, it's a straight line right into DC. So it works for BWR from a geometry perspective. And the station that they're looking at is in the Mount Vernon Square area on the east side of the square.
Okay, thank you.
At New York Avenue. So this shows the viaduct and elevated section in Prince George's County and part of Anne Arundel County and the district. So the red area shows the section that is in tunnel. The blue is the elevated or viaduct section. So as far as in Prince George's County, as I mentioned earlier, the facility is completely underground in the district. As it comes out of the district, it stays underground past the Beltway, past Greenbelt, and in the USDA BARC area around 295, that's where it comes above ground, becomes viaduct, is above ground, into Prince George's County and around, or into Anne Arundel County, I'm sorry, and then in the area of where Fort Meade is, it goes back underground until it gets to BWI, stays underground all the way into Baltimore City.
So the length above ground in the Prince George's area is about what the length?
I don't have that specifically offhand. It's over half of the alignment in Prince George's County is underground, but I can get the specifics. Mileage above ground, below ground in Prince George's County, get that back to you.
Thank you.
And then also there's a transition area. So when it's coming from tunnel to elevated section, there's a transition portal, which is required, as I mentioned, around the USDA BARC property. And I've got a rendering that shows what that would look like.
I've got one question. I'm sorry.
Sure.
Mr. Smith, the tunnel, is that running parallel to a road over in Prince George's County when it comes out? It's coming out of DC, and then there's another. I see the alignment, but the line next to it.
Yeah, it's not necessarily following a street. So as I mentioned earlier, they have these design criteria and geometry requirements. So there's not a street that goes exactly, in that straight line, in that curvature that meets their requirements to operate at 311 miles an hour. So they are underground in that tunnel, and what that allows them to do is go under a number of different types of land uses above, not necessarily completely streets. So there's some commercial properties, there's some residential properties, there's all kinds of properties that tunnel is going under, not entirely a street grid or street network.
But the line that's parallel to it, is that a road? That's my question. See, to the left of, you have the alignment, the tunnel alignment, and then to the left is that?
Can you
This is the other alignment. I think the east side here is bolded just to kind of highlight for you tunnel versus viaduct. And then I think if it was bolded here, it would get a little bit messy and maybe overlap. So that's why there's different line weights.
So is the BWP West alignment, is that viaduct or that would also be tunnel if they went to the west?
So on the west side, the red line comes up to here. So generally right in that same area.
I'm sorry, because we can't follow. Can you right click your pointer and put it on the laser?
I have it here, yeah.
Yeah, I got
Do
it.
You see that?
No, we can't.
Can you? You can see
on the screen.
It's very faint.
Yeah. I see the line, but I don't see the point.
I see it moving. It's right very.
I don't know. Do I have a laser pointer?
Right-click your mouse.
Someone who knows how to do that. We do that.
Okay.
For
okay.
I'm telling him.
Okay.
Right-click your
you
mouse.
Can you see this?
Okay, and then select laser. I can't hardly see.
I see it. Okay, I see the pointer now. Well, I did.
Yeah, I don't see anything about a laser.
So that's why I was trying to get someone to show you, okay. Because we have to do it every week.
I can't even read that.
We're trying to get the little red dot.
Madam Chair, this is James. It doesn't show up on the PowerPoint presentation, but on a PDF it shows up. Normally our presentations are in a PDF.
Oh, I see. Okay, thank you. Okay, well, keep all going.
So I can just talk in general. So from the south side, and this is in Prince George's County, I think that what you guys would most be interested in, the area where it transitions from tunnel to viaduct is generally in the same exact area, depending on if it's on the east side or the west side. Okay. There is some variation as it extends north, but that's in the Anne Arundel County section.
Okay, that was my question as to whether or not the both tunnels ended more or less at the same
spot. It's generally in the same area, and then I've got a rendering that should give you a better idea as well. Great. So this rendering shows what the viaduct section would look like adjacent to the BW Parkway. So on the right-hand side, these two pictures show the no build or the current conditions. And then on the left side, it shows the build condition. So the top left-hand corner is J1. So this is the Parkway West alternative. So this is looking southbound at Powder Mill Road. So in the bottom corner of your screen here, you see this is southbound BW Parkway. And then the viaduct would be off in the distance there at an elevation on the west side of BW Parkway, up in the air.
I know we have a lot of questions and whatnot, too, and I'm going to want some more information at some point, but I am concerned about the viaduct possibly affecting Patuxent River Park, because that's what your notes say, right?
Yeah, so to the extent that the viaduct section goes near or through the park on the west side, there may be some impacts. And then on the bottom left-hand side, this is the J alignment, which is the parkway on the east side. This is looking northbound at the Maryland, around Maryland 197. So this shows a rendering of the tunnel portal transition section. So again, on the right-hand side here, we've got the no build or the existing conditions. All these pictures are BW Parkway looking to the north. So on that J portal at Bark, which is the top left-hand rendering, we've got the parkway in the center of the screen here looking northbound. And so J, which is the alignment that's on the east side of the parkway, shows the transition portal coming out on USDA Bark property and extending north. J1, which is that bottom left-hand graphic, again shows BW Parkway looking north in the center of the screen. And then off to the left-hand side on the west side of the parkway is where that portal would come out in USDA Bark property and transition to the viaduct section and extend north. Any questions here? Got it. All right, as far as recent activities and agency coordination, so back in November of last year, 2018, we published the alternatives report, which got the alternatives under consideration project components down to what I've talked about today. So we had, prior to that, we had a couple more alternatives that we were looking at, but that report got it down to, from an alignment perspective, the two BW Parkway alignments, and then also the maintenance facilities were screened out. None of those are being proposed in Prince George's County, but we've got two maintenance facilities that we're looking at. And then also the station locations. Again, none in Prince George's County, but we got the station locations down to what we're considering. So that was published in November. In December, we followed up with the public agency coordination plan. So this documents and basically puts on record the public outreach plan and the agency coordination plan. that is being used to manage this project. So we updated that with an updated project schedule, put that out on the website and shared that with all of the agencies, and then also updated our frequently asked questions about the project and updated the website to reflect the current status of the project.
What's a URL for the website?
I have that on the last slide. It's bwmaglev.info.
Oh, got it. Okay, that's fine.
You got that on the last
yeah.
slide? As far as next steps, so we are wrapping up our latest round of agency input associated with the current status of the project. We're finishing or have finished up field work that I talked about earlier. That's all being wrapped up, compiled in the draft environmental impact statement, which will be going out and released to the public in the fall of this year. We're targeting late October for that to happen. Once the document has been approved and released by Federal Railroad Administration, there will be a comment period. During that comment period, we'll hold a series of public hearings up and down the corridor. This will provide an opportunity for the public to come learn about the current status of the project, provide formal testimony and comments on where we are in the process. Those comments will be documented, considered, evaluated as we prepare the final environmental impact statement and record of decision, which our schedule right now has the Federal Railroad Administration approving that in the summer of 2020. Once that milestone happens, the NEPA process and the environmental process will be done, and we will close out the grant-related activities with FRA, and the project will, pending funding, advance to the next phase. So the project website is listed here, bwmaglev.info. So this has all the project reports, documents, everything that we've done so far that's of note, of consequence. We upload those reports and documents to the project website. We've got information about the public meetings that we've held to date, those meeting materials. Everything is uploaded there. There's background about the project, frequently asked questions. That's the repository for all project-related activities. People are allowed to go on there, view mapping, provide comments, sign up for a mailing list. So that really has everything from a public standpoint that you would want to know about the project.
Okay.
So that's everything that I had. As I said, I'm happy to answer any questions that you guys have.
I've got one. Who are the entities that make up BWRR? I mean, somebody's funding BWRR, so who are the entities that make up, are they American companies, are they Chinese companies, are they European?
Yeah, so BWRR is a American company based in Maryland.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, they have headquarters in Baltimore.
But the funding comes from the grant, the federal grant, right? I mean,
Well, they have their own funding as
right.
well. They're providing match towards the grant.
Yeah.
So they, they raise funding and have equity associated with the project that, any private company would have.
I understand that it's a Maryland company, but I'm trying to figure out who created it, who instituted it. Was it a consortium of other corporations? Somebody had to create BWRR. That's what I'm in.
Yeah, I don't have the exact history of of all the partners and where they get their funding. We have our contacts there. There's an owner that's very heavily involved. There's a staff that's heavily involved. I have my contacts there. I can get you in touch with them if you want more information about
the
history.
Well, maybe
the
question is, are they a privately owned company or publicly traded?
Private.
Private, okay.
Correct.
Okay. Are there other questions?
Yeah, just real quick.
Okay.
So the hyperlink in that slide doesn't work. You actually misspelled. If you hover over it, the G and the L are flipped. So just make sure you change that later.
Sure.
That way, if you distribute the slides, it'll actually work.
Okay.
Kind of following up on my comment, I hope then that you will provide the LOD to our staff and solicit their comments. Because if you want our buy-in, don't wait till the end. We are, like I said, literally across the street from that docked. And if you're going to be doing any kind of work on that property,
you should worry about it, because we got this today, so I'll walk this down and give it to you.
Sure.
It's about the park that you guys would mess up if you don't do it right.
Yep.
So I want to make sure that it's done right, and that you incorporate our staff. So I'll give you this, because it has a bunch of information about all the programs. We've got pictures in here. There's kayaks, there's kids events, there's a waterfront park festival that we have artists that come in. There's a ton of stuff that goes on here year round. This is just a summer, or this is a 2019 calendar event. So
it's very historic, the War of 1812 played an important role there.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to stop right now, because we have an ambitious agenda. And so, Mr. Taylor, you wish to speak for 3 minutes? Okay, so normally we don't do this. You have 3 minutes to come and say, it's not question and answer. If you have comments, this is just a briefing. We're making no decision. So you want to comment on the briefing. Please identify yourself for the record.
Thank you, Chair Hewlett. My name is Jonathan Taylor. I live in Greenbelt, Maryland. And I am here today. I was responding to the last slide where the presenter said that they're still receiving comments in preparation of the draft EIS. So what I have today is a specific question.
Okay, so the question to, and answer.
I have a specific request that something be included in that draft EIS.
Okay, you can say it to us. Okay, otherwise you can also address them. So.
Okay. So I'm coming personal. My address reveals my close location to this project. I live, my children play close to where this alignment is proposed. The park, the waterfront park that Commissioner Dorner spoke about, I have spent Father's Day with my children on that water. When my oldest daughter was trying to decompress after an entrance exam, she requested to go boating on that park. I am a resident of Greenbelt City and Prince George's County, and so I have an interest in the anything that would affect the distribution of traffic and the effect that would have on the localities along the route of the BW Parkway and the attractions that this project could divert people away from, including our flagship MGM casino. And the effect of that has on the revenue streams that support our education and the cities, and mine in particular. So these things have brought me out to ask the following thing for inclusion in the draft EIS. It seems to me that there is an alternative that has not been discussed in this process, and I am requesting that it be included in some way, because it seems to have better environmental effects, and that is the alternative proposed by the Boring Company. Their project, which is underground all the way and seems to follow within the right-of-way of the Baltimore Parkway, so it doesn't go under people's houses and whatnot. All this strikes me as better in some sense.
Okay.
And if it is or if it isn't, it is at least an alternative. So my question is, will you please include an analysis of this alternative in the draft EIS? That's the question.
Okay.
To put in the draft EIS.
Thank you. Okay. And you have a way of submitting that in writing if you like, okay? To MDOT and their other, you know, I know you have a lot of citizen input and public forums. I know I attended the one at Bowie State University myself, so hopefully you'll stay engaged, okay? And you heard the suggestion.
Yep. We got
take
it.
Back. Okay.
With that,
I'm going to thank you, Mr. Smith, for coming down from Maryland Department of Transportation and making your presentation.
Thank you.
Okay? Thank you for having
okay.
me.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I did get it right? You looked at me like that.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Okay, so we're going to proceed with our agenda. First of all, we had a number of passings, and as always, we want to recognize those who have passed on and have a moment of silence. Cynthia Ann Day and Nathaniel Edwards Holmes were the engaged couple of Upper Marlboro in Prince George's County whose bodies were discovered in a hotel room after a mysterious death at a Dominican Republic resort. And then discovered that Miranda Sharp Warner of Allentown, Pennsylvania, also died 5 days earlier from the same resort. Anika Brown, age 46, of Clinton, the victim of a suspected murder-suicide. The victims of the mass shooting at a Virginia Beach municipal building on Friday, May 31st, all 12 victims killed in the attack and those who were injured. Lee Chase, age 96, famed Creole chef from New Orleans, owner of Zuki Chase Restaurant, served as a meeting place for civil rights workers and entertainers, and banana pudding, okay, and served the Freedom Riders, Presidents George Bush and Barack Obama, Reverend Martin Luther King Sr., Sarah Vaughan, Nat King Cole, just to name a few. And the Disney movie, The Princess and the Frog, was based on Ms. Chase. Ed Marin. Ed Marin was a law partner of my former firm, one of my former law firms, Myers, Rodbell, and Rosenbaum, specialized in estate planning, estate trust and administration, passed away after a courageous fight against with cancer. Lawrence Leathers, age 37, Grammy-winning jazz drummer, was found strangled in a Bronx building stairwell. Malia Davis, age 4, Houston girl, reported missing in early May. Her remains were found in Arkansas by a roadside mowing crew. David and Michelle Paul, the Texas couple on a honeymoon in Fiji, both died from an unidentified illness. Robert Rosenthal, age 91, joined his father in 1954 to build the Rosenthal Automotive Group, consisting of 14 auto dealerships. Carmine Cardi, age 83, best known for his role in The Godfather, Part 2. Mm-hmm. He was one of the Rosado brothers that Frank Pantangeli wanted to get. Okay. Roger O'Harrison, age 93, a television and stage writer, penned the book for Broadway musical Pippin. Leon Redbone, acclaimed 1970s blues and jazz artist. William Tully Brown, age 96, was an American World War II Navajo code talker. And these people helped, those Navajo code talkers created their own, had their own language, and it was a way of communicating during wartime. And they actually helped save thousands upon thousands of lives. Don Frazier, age 95, former congressman and Minneapolis mayor, served in the U.S. House of Representatives and 4 terms as mayor of Minneapolis. Thad Cochran, age 81, former U.S. senator from Mississippi. Everett Raymond Kinsler, age 92, renowned portrait artist. His paintings captured 8 U.S. presidents and cabinet officers and elite celebrities. He has 84 works in the National Portrait Gallery's collection. So if we could have a moment of silence for those and for any of you who may have suffered losses. Thank you. It's June 6th, so it is drive-in movie day because on June 6th, 1933, the first drive-in theater opened, and that was in Camden, New Jersey. Some of you will remember drive-in movies, and some of you look like you may have never been to a drive-in movie. it is National Eyewear Day, and it is the 75th anniversary of D-Day. When, during World War II, the Battle of Normandy, at least 156,000 American, British, and Canadian forces landed along the fortified coast of France's Normandy region, liberating Western Europe from Nazi Germany control. June 6, 1925, Walter Chrysler founded the Chrysler Corporation. June 6, 1934, the SEC was established. June 6, 1965. Okay, some of you will remember this, some of you not. I think Mr. Balaji might remember this. Rolling Stones released, I Can't Get No
Satisfaction.
Okay, and by the way, they are coming to Prince George's County in 4 weeks. Mm-hmm. They will be at FedEx Field. June 6, 1968, former Attorney General, U.S. Senator and presidential candidate Robert F. Kennedy died after being assassinated the night before. June 6, 1972, David Bowie released his breakthrough album, The Rise and Fall of Ziggy Stardust and the Spiders from Mars. June 6, 2018, LeBron James eclipsed Michael Jordan's record for the most 30-point games in NBA playoff history. And speaking of NBA playoffs, okay, I don't know how many of you saw the Toronto game versus the Warriors last night. Okay, how about, so the Warriors didn't win. Toronto did win. Warriors play great defense. How about Steph Curry's 47 points? Yeah. 47 points, okay. And so they were missing Klay Thompson and also our own Kevin Durant, you know. And so, anyway. Also, it's the end of James Holzhauer's Jeopardy reign. He was toppled by 27-year-old Emma, the librarian, 27. So he did not beat Ken Jennings' record for number of games won or money received, but he did win nearly $2.5 million in 33 or so days, nothing to sneeze at. In the food department, it is Georgia Blueberry Month, Country Cooking Month, California Avocado Month, Dairy Month, National Iced Tea Month, that's regular iced tea, not Long Island, National Soul Food Month. I do want to take a moment to say congratulations to Commissioner Dorner, who was a participant in HUD's Innovative Housing Solutions Showcase over this weekend, where they talked about housing options, affordable housing, new building technologies, more resilience following natural disasters, and so much more. But he was called upon because of his tremendous expertise. And we want to give a huge shout-out and congratulations to Commissioner Dorner. Two more things. Finally, June 9th, this Saturday, is the Beltway Barbecue. It's going to be at Showplace Arena at Pennsylvania Avenue, right across the street. It is fabulous. It is a barbecue showdown. And there are flyers in the back. I invite you to attend. And no. So that will be Saturday. And then finally, I had one other thing. And that is, so we're recessing at 11 o'clock. Because we have to have a full commission meeting. So I wanted to put this out there now, because wherever we are in these proceedings, at 11 o'clock we are stopping for that. And I will make this other announcement. So without further ado, I'm going to proceed with our agenda. Let me say first that 3B has been removed from the agenda. So if you were here for that, that's been removed. We just heard 3C. Is there anyone here to oppose the staff's recommendations on items 4, B, C, or D, or any board member wishes to discuss these items?
Madam Chair, I move adoption of the staff findings and approval of the items on the consent agenda in accordance with the recommendations of staff.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. Is there any request to hear item number 5? It is a zoning case, A10050 Bowman property.
Madam Chair, just a quick note to the board. The staff received the statement of justification in time for this case. It was dated on January 23rd, 2019. Inadvertently, we did not place it in the backup for the board, but what we have done since then, we have provided you all a copy as well as published it in the website.
Thank you. But was there any request to hear? Mr. Ferrara, you're not here to speak. Where are you? Okay, there. You're not here to speak. You just signed up. Okay. So there's no request to hear. Okay. Is there any desire on the part of the board to hear? Hearing none. Item 6, a preliminary plan 4-17033, Tinker's Preserve. Ms. Turnquist, I know you're presenting. Who's here to speak? I can't read this. Is it Clancy?
Clay.
Is it Clay? C-L-A-Y. Okay. Mr. Clay, are you going to wish to speak?
No.
Okay. Ms. Turnquist, because we're stopping at 11.
Yes, ma'am. Good morning, Madam Chair and members of the board. For the record, I am Amber Turnquist with the Subdivision and Zoning Section. Item number 6 before you is a preliminary plan of subdivision for Tinker's Preserve. The subject site proposes 22 lots and 4 parcels for a single-family detached development. The site is located in the southwestern area of Prince George's County within Planning Area 81 in Council District 9. More specifically, the site is located approximately 160 feet west of the intersection of Rosecrans Drive and Tarquin Avenue. The subject site is zoned R80 and is comprised of 14.08 acres. Coolridge Drive abuts the site to the north, and Rosecrans Drive abuts the site to the east. Adjacent property to the north, east, and south are zoned R80 and developed with residential uses. Property to the east is zoned ROS, and the existing land use is parks and open space. The site is within the military installation overlay zone for height. The height of proposed structures will be required to comply with the maximum height requirement. The aerial photograph shows the subject site is currently vacant. The site map shows that the eastern portion of the site is relatively flat and then slopes north and west toward the two adjacent on-site stream systems. There are no master plan facilities adjacent to the site. Sole access to the development is proposed from Rosecrans Drive. This slide shows the two critical intersections which were analyzed for transportation impacts in the vicinity of the site. It was found that the intersections would operate adequately under total traffic conditions and that adequate transportation facilities will exist to serve the site with the conditions set forth in the technical staff report. The property is located within the Branch Avenue corridor and is subject to off-site bicycle and pedestrian improvements. Off-site sidewalk improvements are provided along Rosecrans Drive from the site's eastern edge to the intersection with Tarquin Avenue, which will improve ADA accessibility and pedestrian access. Therefore, adequate bicycle and pedestrian facilities will exist to serve the site. The preliminary plan of subdivision is proposed to subdivide the property into 22 lots and 4 parcels for a single-family detached development. All lots meet or exceed the lot requirements of the R80 zone. Tinker's Creek traverses the western portion of the property. Mandatory dedication is to be satisfied through the dedication of the westernmost parcel to M-NCPPC. Adequate public facilities, including water, sewer, fire, rescue, and police facilities, are available to serve the subject site. The TCP depicts the proposed site layout with public streets in blue, woodland preservation areas in light green, and stormwater management facilities in dark green. A variance request for the removal of 4 specimen trees was submitted, and findings to support the variance are included on pages 14 and 15 of the technical staff report. Three PMA impacts to the PMA are proposed in green and were evaluated with this application as detailed on pages 16 and 17 of the staff report. Staff finds that the impacts are necessary to support development on the site and recommends approval of the PMA impacts. 2 of the PMA impacts related to utility work are proposed on the property to be conveyed to the Department of Parks and Recreation. The department has provided an email stating that it is aware of the related disturbance and concurs with the impacts. This finding will be further clarified in the resolution. Staff recommends that the Planning Board adopt the findings and approve Preliminary Plan of Subdivision 4-17033. TCP 1-003-2019 and variance to section 25-122B1G, subject to the 12 conditions contained in the staff report. This concludes staff's presentation.
Thank you, Ms. Turnquest. Are there any questions? Was there anyone to speak on this matter? Mr. Clay, you're here in support, correct? Okay, so please let the record reflect Mr. Clay is here on in support of the application. No one else to speak. Is there a motion?
Madam Chair, I move that we adopt the findings of staff and approve Preliminary Plan 4-17033, TCP 1-003-2019, and variance to Section 25-122B1G, along with the associated conditions as outlined in staff's report.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. Okay, so for the record, I'm going to announce that the Planning Board is going to go into recess in preparation for our 11 o'clock full commission meeting with the Montgomery County Board. So it'll be a full Maryland National Capital Park and Planning Commission meeting, which will be held via telephone conference here with our colleagues in Montgomery County. And the meeting will, in fact, be recorded and streamed. Thank you. We're going to take about a 4-minute recess.
Okay.
Before we begin, both boards are in recess, and we're going to convene the meeting of the full Maryland National Capital Park and Planning Commission. And I'm ensuring that you would prefer it in the version of a roll call?
At least you identifying all the members that are present and have Vice Chairman Anderson indicate the members who are present here in Silver Spring.
All right, let me just say this. And for Prince George's County, we have the entire board. We have myself as chair. We have Vice Chair Bailey and Commissioners Giraldo, Washington, and Dorner present. And Montgomery County?
This all is five. John Nissel.
We have all five members of the Montgomery board here.
Okay, thank you. So for the record, I'd like the minutes to reflect that that both planning boards are in recess to assemble for a special meeting of the full Maryland National Capital Park and Planning Commission. It's being held via telephone conference in this auditorium. For the record, it's being recorded. This meeting is being recorded. And if you do not wish to be recorded, please either disconnect from the line or leave the auditorium. With that, I would like for someone to give us to put this in perspective. I think I'm going to turn to our general counsel for starters, Mr. Gardner.
Good morning again. For the record, my name is Adrian Gardner. I'm the general counsel of the Park and Planning Commission. Good morning, Madam Chairman, Mr. Vice Chairman, members of the commission. About 2 months ago, or several months ago, the planning staff presented the commission and each board with a laundry list of about 20 reasons for basis of concern with respect to the managed lanes project that's being proposed to widen I-270 and the Capitol Beltway. That is not actually what this meeting is about. This meeting is about four of those issues that are presented in a one-page summary that the staff has prepared that is captioned Summary of Staff Recommendations for ARD's Non-Concurrence. And to simply put that in perspective before I turn to Ms. Rubin and to Crystal in Prince George's, what I'd like to do is simply say that the frame of reference here is whether or not the state has proposed alternatives that will generate a viable environmental impact study. That is really the ultimate question. And for that reason, we're not actually addressing, and we haven't addressed every single issue that may come out, because we believe that the process will take care of many of those issues. The four issues that staff are presenting today are what are considered sort of game stoppers. They are essentially the significant issues that the EIS has to accommodate and has to capture appropriately, and we've heard nothing that assures us that those things will happen. So with that in mind, I would simply say for the record that both boards have received memorandums from the staff. We know that there's an update due because of the events yesterday regarding the State Board of Public Works and the approval to go through with one segment for a public-private partnership as a delivery model to produce the project. I think staff's view is that that is not any reason to change course at this point, and we'll come back to that on the end if the commissioners would desire to talk about those current events. Ms. Rubin is prepared to do that. So with that, I would, unless there are questions at this stage, I would hand it off to Ms. Rubin.
Okay, let me see if there are any questions. Are there any questions of Mr. Gardner at this point? Hearing none, Ms. Rubin?
The only question I have is at some point we will be able to discuss this ourselves, right? Before the vote. Right now we're just in the presentation stage.
Yes. Correct. And Commissioner Dreyfus, maybe the way to put this is that what the staff is actually asking for to frame the actual decision is we're asking for a vote of the commission for the chairman and the vice chairman to sign a letter directing or communicating with State Highway the reasons for non-concurrence that are spelled out in this summary.
Correct.
I would request also that when that letter goes out, it has whatever the vote is going to be.
That's fine. I think
I have one question in regarding the Board of Public Works meeting. I wanted to know whether any elected official from Montgomery testified, either or Prince George's, the county, either the county exec or the president of the county council. Were there anyone speaking on behalf of Montgomery County or Prince George's County that
yes.
was official? Of,
yes.
of those counties.
Okay.
And who might that be?
For Montgomery County, both County Executive Ehrlich and Council
Ehrlich,
Member
yeah.
Tom Hucker,
Ehrlich, yeah.
and Council Member Tom Hucker, who chairs the Transportation Environmental
okay.
Committee. and then for Montgomery County. No one appeared on behalf of Prince George's County, and there was a there were several elected officials from Charles County and Frederick County.
Okay.
And no one from the commission testified.
Correct. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, so without further ado, if there are no other questions, and I know we will have the opportunity for discussion. Also, I would let the record reflect that in public session, we had some briefings. The respective planning boards had some briefings a week ago, so we are pretty much up to date. So we had, Prince George's had ours last week. I know Montgomery County had yours last week, so we're pretty informed, and hopefully, you know, we'll have some discussion, but hopefully not unduly repetitive. Ms. Rubin, you're on.
Great. Carol Rubin for the record. And I'm going to be sharing the presentation with Crystal Hancock for on the Prince George's County side.
Yes.
So the four issues you have before you are really very, very focused, because as Mr. Gardner indicated, there are very specific reasons that staff is recommending the commission does not concur on the alternatives retained for detailed study, because we believe that without addressing these four issues, the state highway administration cannot reach adequate conclusions on an environmental impact statement, which is what the NEPA process is about. It's about putting together an environmental impact statement for the project. And just to clarify, yesterday's meeting at the Board of Public Works, although some of the issues that we're raising were addressed during that hearing, those are not related to the NEPA study. They are simply related to the solicitation, so that the Board of Public Works gave specific direction to the Maryland Department of Transportation about how they should approach the solicitation with the private sector on a public-private partnership. It is not about NEPA. In fact, just so that you're aware, I've confirmed with the Maryland Department, the State Highway Administration, that they still expect next week, June the 12th, to have responses from agencies on concurrence or non-concurrence of the alternatives that are currently proposed under the NEPA study. Okay.
Mr. Rubin, Madam Chair, this is Tina Patterson speaking. My question is, if I heard you correctly, that the Board of Public Works decision was as it relates to the procurement, but if the procurement does not cover these areas, and I'm specifically thinking about the Termini, will there be opportunity to go back and revise the scope of work so that it does address item number two that's listed here?
I think that'll be part of the discussion about the solicitation that we can have later on.
Okay.
But as the current NEPA study is, those termini are the termini of the study, so they can't be changed in this particular NEPA action. But they could be, there is a way potentially to incorporate or merge other studies that are proposed.
Okay, I'll wait until we get to that juncture.
I just want to comment on that, Gerald Sushi, comment on that point. I did send the Montgomery County staff. I was very tempted to want to testify myself. I avoided that in respect of my position on the planning board. But again, my sense was that if some specifics were provided to the Board of Public Works, it could have a greater incorporation of what the termini or the combinations of these are. For instance, the I-270 project, it is a key to put the west side of the 495 to the American Legion Bridge in the I-2 study corridor. Other issues, certainly extending the 495 to the Woodrow Wilson Bridge and all that, those I think could have been defined in the process. And I don't know whether it's possible to go back to the Port of Works and have them direct the State Department of Transportation to adjust the limits of the projects.
Okay, so that's a good segue, Commissioner, into the first issue,
okay,
which is segmentation and phasing. Because the study area, the current 495-270 study area includes the American Legion Bridge up all the way around 495 to 90 to Maryland 5 and up to 70 north 270 up to 370. The issue that you're raising about potentially including the American Legion Bridge and the portion of 495 until it gets to the spur as part of the solicitation, that's where we're going to address it as part of the NEPA study, because we're asking exactly that as part of, we're looking at exactly that as part of the segmentation and phasing. So in other words, for the study area phasing, the alternative phasing that they've looked at, we're asking that they segment and phase the project in order for the Western Corridor, which is the American Legion Bridge, all the way up to, actually, we're asking that they, it has to do with the termini, we're asking to go all the way north to Frederick, we're calling that the Western Corridor, be phase one of this project. So it's the segmentation of how the alternatives are reviewed and the phasing. We're asking that that be the first phase of the NEPA project, because if you, part of the purpose and need requires to look at an environmental impact, you're looking at avoidance first of impact to resources. So you're looking at first of various resources. So you're looking first at avoidance, then at minimization of impact, and then finally mitigation. So in order to understand whether the resources, the environmental resources, and I include many, not just parkland, but cultural resources, historic resources, et cetera. The only way that we can judge whether or not those impacts can be avoided or even minimized is to consider the planning of the project to determine whether or not the scope, whether or not you even need to address, for example, the 495 constrained area. There are other ways to plan the project to allow for avoidance or to minimization, because it's not simply about engineering drawings and therefore you can, you know, narrow the roadway. It's about a plan that establishes the scope overall of how the impacts occur. So in order to do that, you have to have a very comprehensive regional plan that is appropriately scoped, phased, and segmented in order to understand how to really, what those impacts are going to be. And we don't believe that the State Highway Administration has defined the scope in a way of the project, the segmentation and the phasing, to allow us to understand what those impacts are.
I agree with you. They're spending $100 million to make temporary improvements on this section of I-270 from I-370 down to the Beltway, and basically then making that the first phase, you're going to take some of those out that are actually being implemented. But again, I just felt that the Board of Public Works, the governor, et cetera, could have told the Secretary of Transportation, who would tell the State Highway Administrator, yes, here's some positive suggestions, kind of win-win suggestions from the two counties that would kind of meet their needs and their concerns. And I think that whether it's possible to go back, but if you're confident this can be addressed in the next phase, that would be great.
So, Commissioner Cici, let me just jump in, and I think that you've actually agreed with the first point that's being made, because at this level of analysis, we're not actually even in the realm of the details that you're talking about. This is really, at this point, a question of we're being asked whether or not what's currently on the table and what's currently being proposed is going to adequately assess the potential environmental impacts. You're making some suggestions that will actually be an iterative process, but for what's on the table right now, I think you just agreed. The way I take what you said is that is actually an agreement. So if that's okay, I'm going to suggest that we move on to point number two, and turn it over, ask Chris.
We're not taking a vote on each one right now, are we?
I didn't think you needed to.
You said it was an agreement.
No, I just...
Oh, excuse me. I think he just concurred with that first point, but I...
because that don't occur.
Okay, I understand. We're not taking a vote at all.
We'll wait until we have a discussion.
Very well, Commissioner Dreyfus. Why don't we toss it over to Crystal Hancock to talk about the second point?
Good morning. Crystal Hancock, on behalf of the
Crystal, we're having very difficult time hearing you here, so can you try to get to the microphone as close as possible?
Okay, hold on a second. Hold on. Crystal, you can come up here if that makes sense.
Good morning. Is this better? No.
Is that better? Because they're on the phone here.
You should see it where you are. Ready.
Hold on 1 second. Okay. Can we bring her up here?
Yeah.
Something over there needs to be turned off. Okay. Sit here. Let me see if that works. It should be on.
Oh, sorry. Good morning. This is Crystal Saunders Hancock from the Countywide Planning Division.
Can you hear her?
No, we cannot.
Come over here.
Good morning again. This is Crystal Saunders Hancock from the Countywide Planning Department. Can you hear me now?
It's this microphone.
You're in the phone.
Oh, duh. No wonder they can't hear me.
Right. Sorry.
Good morning. This is Crystal Saunders Hancock calling from the county from the Countywide Planning Department. Can you hear me?
Much better. Yes.
Okay. Perfect. Sorry. I'm here to speak on behalf of the termini of the project. The concerns that staff has is that the existing project does not include the termini along I-270 from 495 to. I'm sorry, from along I-270 from 370 north to Frederick. And also, it does not include the portion from Maryland 5 south to the Woodrow Wilson Bridge. Staff concerns are that if this is more of a regional project, they have not included a part of the region that we think is essential to move forward with the project. The impacts from those areas will be incomplete and further study will be needed.
I have a comment on that, and again, I did a very crude financial analysis. I was involved in the P3s under Secretary Flanagan, and again, looking, I'm concerned that the part where most traffic would be in Montgomery County, and unless that's incorporated with the section to Frederick and also to the bridge, American Legion Bridge, there's some questions about sustainability of the whole project. At some point, yes, it can be broken up in design segments, but I think that's very important. And obviously, again, there was a lot of effort on the Woodrow Wilson Bridge to have the 11th and 12th lanes structurally strong enough to take metro rail, to take light rail, or bus rapid transit. So again, to leave that gap where that is also in D.C., part of the bridge is in the District of Columbia, and then the district has Interstate 295 coming down to that area. To leave that opening between Route 5 and the Woodrow Wilson Bridge is a concern. And again, there should be the person on is Susan Shore from VDOT is working on the American Legion. Happened to work with her in the past. But again, working with VDOT for the segment from the Woodrow Wilson Bridge to the interchange of Interstate 395, 495, and 95 would be something that Virginia would be interested in working with Maryland on for a total regional solution, and I think that's the point of it.
Okay. I think we agree. Okay.
All right.
Anything else, Ms. Hancock, at this point? Okay. Ms. Rubin?
All right, so that takes us into the question of transit. The alternatives do not include a transit component that would be on any of the alternatives. The State Highway Administration removed 14, alternative 14, which included some transit. The response was that transit won't work as a standalone. Our response to that is we don't believe that the highway can work as a standalone, that it needs to be an integral, that transit and locally serving transit needs to be an integral component. Although the State Highway Administration has indicated that they would allow buses on the managed lanes, we don't think that's locally serving. That simply brings more. It doesn't really address the point of drawing people off of the highway, either through alternative transportation means or to allow people to get to other transit without having to drive again on the highway system. And that means that we don't really understand what the impacts are going to be because we don't have a full view of what the true use of the after looking at different transportation alternatives, what the actual impacts will be for how many people will use the road system, how many people will use other means of transit. And this is, and the project itself under the purpose and need is supposed to address not only through traffic and regional traffic, but it's supposed to address commuting traffic. So without a meaningful local serving transit component to the alternatives to study, because remember, this is moving them forward for study. If transit is not a component, it won't be studied. So we need that in there to understand the full impact of the project.
Okay. What is that? What you told us when we started is that your concerns are environmental. If how does the transit in or out affect it? If it's out, then they don't study it, and so environmentally, it's not a factor. So why is putting it in solve an environmental problem?
Well, it has to do with the size of the project, the needs. For example, whether the alternatives that are on the table are all about adding, you know, various multiple lanes for to move cars. We don't know how many lanes. We don't know what the needs are going to be. You don't know where any of the access points are going to be required unless you understand a system, a transportation system, as a comprehensive system. So the reason it impacts the environment is because we can't do an appropriate full environmental impact if we don't know what the impact to the environment is going to be.
But if they are putting this out to potential bidders who are going to then come up with a design, and once the design is shown to the State Highway Administration, they can do an environmental impact on what the proposals are to see what they are. But before they get a design, because they're not designing it, before they get a design, they can't do an environmental impact on the areas you're talking about.
Under NEPA and under this project schedule, the environmental impact statement, the draft environmental impact statement, has to be complete before a contract can even go out to bid, so that the design can't be completed or even begun until, in an engineering type of view, until we know what the environmental impacts are going to be.
Why is that our problem? The state has to comply with NEPA, and they would then be subject to having a problem, but why is it our problem?
We are named as a cooperating agency. What that means is the NEPA requires that we address certain stages during the project. This is a stage which is, do we concur that the alternatives retained for detailed study are reasonable and sufficient to move forward so that they can, is there enough information in them to study to get to a preferred alternative? And what we're saying is they're incomplete. The package, essentially the package of alternatives is incomplete, and therefore the appropriate studies will not be done to come up with an environmental impact.
But the package that they have agreed to do does not include some of the things you want. So in their view, it's complete.
you don't think it's complete because it doesn't have public transportation in it. But that doesn't mean that it's not complete in their view. And when they do their NEPA study, it's going to be on their plan, not your plan.
Okay.
So we are a cooperating agency, and we are supposed to make our comments at this point, as was indicated in the briefing that we had last week and in the last full commission briefing as well. And I think, I mean, these are the topics that our staff put on, submitted to us in a memo for our consideration to include in a letter. These are our concerns that we are supposed to express at this juncture.
And I agree. I think these are concerns.
Madam Chair, for the record, Adrian Gardner again, and maybe this will help Commissioner Dreyfus, because I'm trying to make it actually connect one dot. Our role in this is actually statutory, and we are obligated to actually raise these issues at this, you know, at these appropriate times. And our jurisdiction comes out of the federal Capra-Crampton Act and also the responsibilities that we have under the state code, which I'll talk about in connection with parkland. But to make it very concrete, if the alternatives don't address transit and you're assuming no transit in the solution for traffic on those highway facilities, then a transit facility will affect the trip count one way or the other. And if you're not studying it, you're not going to know how it's going to affect the trip count. If you're not studying the right thing, you're not going to actually understand the pollution impacts. You're not going to understand the water quality impacts. And so that's why staff is saying that this is an issue that's essentially a game changer. And it's a showstopper, because if you're not asking the right question, it's not likely that you're going to get the right answer. And that's kind of the point of these isolating these issues. And so I just want to make that connection.
The state is trying to build a road without public money.
Okay.
They're trying to get the private sector to pay for a road that's going to pay for itself. If it is not economically viable for the private sector to make a profit from building this road, it will never happen. The private sector is not going to make money from putting transit in, and that's why they're not including. Not because the state doesn't like transit, but this single purpose is, how do we add lanes, hot lanes, that are going to be paid for by the users that'll support a P3. That's why they're limiting the exposure.
If I could address that, because it has been discussed. We're not telling necessarily, this isn't saying that the NEPA project, that the construction of the highway or the whatever the ultimate project is, has to include that the private that the public sector builds the transit. But for this particular evaluation, we need to understand what the impact of transit will have on the ultimate project. Now, there was discussion about a portion of the revenues from the tolls being dedicated to transit. But without having that element in the evaluation of the project as a whole, we're not going to know what the final environmental impacts are in order to address that, and then how it's going to be dealt with later
or be able to
is part of the negotiation.
All right.
And if the developer says, I can't.
Ms. Rubin? I need for you to stop for a second, because we are somewhat at a disadvantage because we can't see you. And we have board members over there who wish to speak, and we have board members over here who wish to speak.
Okay.
So when you finish, when someone over there wishes to speak, someone let me know that which commissioner wishes to speak, and I'm going to do the same over here.
Okay, I apologize.
So you have no way of knowing this. I just want to let you know, when you finish, I have Commissioner Giraldo over here, okay? So go ahead and proceed.
Okay. So, to summarize, it's not a question of what the developer will include in his project. That's for negotiation at a later date. It's a question of what is the impact going to be, so that we are clear on whether or not what needs to be included in the project for someone to deal with.
Okay.
For study, right now it's for study. So I'm finished with that. I'll
okay.
Proceed.
Thank you. Commissioner Giraldo. Commissioner Giraldo is next.
I don't see the issue so much as who's going to pay for the.
We can't hear anything.
Okay. I don't see the issue so much as who's going to pay for the road.
Okay, you know what? You have to come over here then. That just doesn't work.
The issue for me isn't so much as to who's going to pay for the road. The issue that I see is what our responsibility is to the residents of Prince George's County and Montgomery County in terms of what they want, and second, what impact is going to be on the environment. And so I wholeheartedly agree to see what would have the least impact. You have to consider mass transit, and that's what this proposal fails to do.
Okay, Jerry wants to say, I just would like to add to that point. And again, there is a federal requirement that all major metropolitan areas have a multimodal transportation plan. That is basically what the Transportation Planning Board at COG does. So we have our region has a multimodal transportation plan. The general plans adopted by Montgomery County and Prince George's are both multimodal transportation plans. And I've been in transportation working on since 1957 on the Outer Beltway around Boston. I've been involved with MDOT, USDOT, et cetera. And the issue here is we had Secretary Flanagan come out with a P3 request. We had 12 firms. They were solicited. The question, as an MTA representative, Maryland Transit Administration, the question I asked, could you, if we defined a transit project, finalize the design and construct it, but not operate it, what would it take? And all 12 said, adding, 5 years, 10 years on the concession. If you look at how this project is being financed, the public-private partnership, it's kind of a chance in a lifetime to get both highways and transit implemented in these key corridors. When you look at the Maryland Transportation Fund, which Harry Hughes passed away this year, he was instrumental with the General Assembly setting up a multimodal department. The gas taxes and the registration goes into the Transportation Trust Fund. The state, if they think they can make money on a project, the Maryland Transportation Authority will do it. That's why they're keeping the Baltimore-Washington Parkway. But on this project, the state is not sure that this project, they don't have the money in the trust fund. They're not sure it could be under the Transportation Authority. So they've used this mechanism of a P3. And is my personal estimate is it would generate the I-270, $100 million a year in revenue. What this can do is extend the period rather than 30 years, 50 years, 60 years. The operator of the P3 that's finally awarded could implement some transit elements, perhaps at their option if they wanted to operate it, they could. But they would just extend the life, the state could extend the life of the P3 to cover the cost of key transit improvements in the 270 corridor or in the I-90-45 corridor. The other thing that the state could do, and I think you've mentioned it, is to, if they know where tolls are being collected electronically, they could offer an abatement on the ICC to interstate truck traffic that is coming, through Prince George's to 270. They could use the ICC. So there are many mechanisms under the P3 that certainly could help operations. But it is, to me, it's a chance in a lifetime to get some key, if we know what they are, what the key transit projects in the two counties are.
Okay. Does anyone else have comments at this point? Ms. Rubin?
I'll jump in on point number four, Madam Chair. This is, again, Adrian Gardner. So, essentially, as I mentioned before, the commission has responsibility for public parkland in both counties, and it comes under a number of different statutory sources. And I think the way to express this issue is that we staff was not initially inclined to raise this as one of the independent bases, but now we think we should. And the reason we do is that essentially the state has assumed control. It has control over properties that may or may not be true. And I say that because, for example, we already have an existing agreement with the state that governs the width of the beltway at certain points. That goes back to the initial beltway construction. We're obligated under that agreement. We're expected under that agreement to make that possible. So while the commission does not
intend, no one has proposed utilizing this issue as a mechanism to preclude the project for going forward. The point is that it must be studied for purposes of the impact, because it will have impact on water quality, it will have impact on recreation, it will have impact on passive recreation in both counties, and for that reason, that's the reason we're here, and we expect that that should be something that should be expressly included in the study, and it's not.
Okay. Are there comments on the Montgomery County side?
Jerry Cicci, on that point, you know, when you look at the purple line, seemed to be going well, but other people looked at some of the environmental requirements and began to latch onto them. So what Adrian just mentioned is someone else external, basically in opposition to a program of highways and transit, could grab onto some environmental issue and then just slow down the whole project, which is the worst case if it is awarded to a P3. Because then they're sitting there with no potential to receive revenue.
Okay, are there other comments for the Montgomery County side? Are there any?
Hold on. I think this might be the time for Norman to say his piece.
This actually concludes the presentation.
Yeah, so I think Norman wanted to say something. I'm going to vote against this motion or proposal. I believe that the state is doing the best it can to get something done in a very critical area that is vital to the economic development of our county and Prince George's as well. And all of our requests, while sounding reasonable, will just delay and postpone and probably derail the potential of getting this project done quickly. This is the first stage that was finally approved yesterday, and I believe we should be supportive rather than obstructionists. So I am going to vote against this proposal to raise all these issues, which I think can be adequately addressed at some future date. Thank you.
Okay. So, I'm tempted to respond, but I'm not at this
no,
point.
No.
Okay. Does anyone else over there have comments?
This is Casey Anderson. I just want to say that I understand where Commissioner Dreyfus is coming from, and I really believe that we have established just in the last few days a little bit better path forward, both as a result of the Board of Public Works meeting and also a meeting that I had with Pete Ron and Greg Slater and the project team with Carol Rubin and Derek Berlage of the Prince George's staff on Monday. I think there's a lot that's really unclear, but and I don't think that anything we're doing today either is intended to or has the effect of delaying, killing, or otherwise interfering with the project. But I think we need to get these issues on the record as part of this ARDS process, part of this ARDS decision, in order to preserve the ability to continue working towards resolution on some of them. But I just wanted to say that in light of what Commissioner Dreyfus said.
Thank you. I guess I would associate myself with your comments, Vice Chair Anderson. I think this is not intended to stop anything, but it is intended to flag some very legitimate concerns that must be considered. So are any other comments from Prince George's County side?
Well, this is Commissioner Washington.
Can you hear her?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
I tend to project. and I regret I was not able to be in attendance last week during the briefing, but just having listened to the conversation and some of the comments during the discussion today, I'm somewhat inclined to lean towards Commissioner Dreyfus's position. Now, granted, my leaning has to do much more with maybe not fully appreciating the process, but I certainly do not want us in a posture or position where we are delaying it. I see a lot of the benefits of discussing and raising a number of these issues at the appropriate time. So I guess one question for me to my commission colleagues is, as a result of the briefing and just the process in general, is there an appropriate place for these items to be addressed?
So I guess I would turn to, we have Ms. Hancock there, you have Ms. Rubin over there, we have our general counsel, Mr. Gardner. It's my understanding this is an appropriate time to raise those issues. Mm-hmm. Particularly, let me, there's something to be said for every one of these, but let me just pick item two for the moment.
Yep.
This stopping at Maryland 5 mm-hmm. and not going all the way to the Woodrow Wilson Bridge.
Oh, no, let me be clear. Okay. It's not that I necessarily take exception with the four items as put before us. It really is a procedural question I'm asking,
right,
in that, as explained during the briefing and or conversations last week and or before, and I'm looking towards our staff now, is there a time wherein these items can be addressed? And Norman, you commented that you had a sense that it might delay the process. I wonder what may be driving that. Again, I'm just trying to get some clarity.
Jerry Sisci, I'd like to comment. I think I'm willing to support these. I have some mixed feelings, obviously, my background, and I'm in favor of good transportation. But I think it strengthens the ability of the two chairpersons and the staff, the key, the legal staff and the planning staff, to meet with both MDOT and SHA. And and I see they've asked Kevin Quinn, the transit administrator, to get involved. That would be good to have him at the table to basically strengthen the argument to kind of meet a multimodal perspective. Again, one other thing that has come up, we look at the purple line. I'm not sure I know many houses or businesses were affected on that. But again, we hear this thing about 34 homes. And the other thing that has been done in the past is kind of a community benefit payment that could be made to some of the affected properties if they are really affected. It would allow for the project to move ahead. It would be basically a year on the P3 concession to generate funds to provide additional compensation. And to the degree additional compensation could also provide for better environmental noise protection, et cetera. So on that standpoint, I think this strengthens the ability of the two chairpersons and the key staff to increase the discussions to a point of resolution with both MDOT, State Highway, and MTA.
Okay, stop for a second. Thank you, Commissioner Sisci.
Yeah.
Commissioner Washington has a question on the table. We have Crystal Hancock here. We're going to ask.
But it's not a question. Well, it is a question.
Procedural.
But I want to be clear that every attempt to address what I'm asking gets addressed, because I'm hearing rationale and support of these four items. I'm not disputing that.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I'm not disputing that. Okay. My question is, look, the way this document reads, it says staff has recommended non-concurrence for the following reason. That language is not embracing. It does not suggest collaborating. It does not suggest we are looking to provide input. That's a very okay. But I'm just trying to get clarity.
So that's right. Okay.
Okay.
The briefing, a lot of this was explained. I'm going to turn to Ms. Hancock and Ms. Rubin or Mr. Gardner if you wish to jump in on this. Okay, that would be helpful. Thank you.
Okay, this is Carol.
We have Ms. Hancock and then first, and then Ms. Rubin, you can jump in. Okay.
Hi, this is Crystal Saunders Hancock again. Now is the time for us to move forward on the concerns that we have, because now is the time that we will move the six build alternatives and the one no build alternative forward for detailed study.
Okay. Does that answer your question?
Okay.
That's helpful.
Okay. Ms. Rubin? All right. So if I could just talk about the process.
Well, all I want to say is, in response to Commissioner Washington, the issue you raised is exactly the concern I have. It doesn't say we would like you to consider the following as concerns. It says we are in non-concurrence, which is not anything that looks like, wow, we want to work with you and get this to happen.
Is that the term that's specified? Let me turn to Mr. Gardner and Ms. Rubin, because that's the term we're supposed to use, I believe. Okay.
Correct. Yes. Okay. So under the NEPA process, there's a schedule for steps that go along the way towards development of, to reach the final, the DEIS, the environmental impact statement, so that you can ultimately get to your but before that, to select a preferred alternative, which is what the ultimate project will be. The steps along the way require each of the cooperating agencies to either concur, not concur, or concur with comment on particular steps. Now, the step that's going on now, which is going to close on June the 12th, is the public comment about which of the 15 preliminary alternatives will be retained for study. So what we're saying is, and the seven that have been proposed by the State Highway Administration, what we are saying is, we don't believe that this is a complete package. We would like you to move forward with the transit. We would like you to include the transit option as one of the alternatives to be studied. That's an example. We would like you to address these things as you move forward in your studies. We're not asking for any delay at all. We're asking simply that more information be included in the studies that they are will be beginning at the next stage in the program to get to the final decision. We are exactly on point with the timing. This is the request that came of us. Do you concur? Do you concur with comment, or do you not concur?
And hold on a second. Okay, so thank you, Ms. Rubin. And I know that is that's the terminology that's set forth, so we have to choose one of those. And there's a process even before the non-concurrence, and I think we've endeavored, there was a meeting held earlier. There's a process that we were to follow in the event that we might be headed towards non-concurrence. And so we followed the process every step of the way. And so now is the time. I see Commissioner Washington has a comment too. So
I do. First, thank you. I certainly appreciate that explanation and that perspective. And so based on what you just described, my question would be, are there things that we did concur with and or concur with comment in addition to these four items that we have non-concurrence with? And if so, why is that not before us, just to see it all in full context?
For the record, this is Adrian again. Commissioner Washington, I guess the way that I would describe it is that our role right now is to actually assist the state in scoping what's going to be studied. And the reason we focused on these four issues is because these are the things, as I said before, that I think are essentially game stoppers, because we can conceive of no study that does not address these four things that would produce a viable analysis of the environmental impacts.
Thank you, Adrian, for that comment. I appreciate it. But again, in that same vein, it would still seem likely that we would also articulate what we concur with, and in addition to what we concur with comment on. Because if others, for example, may be providing comments on areas where we concur, then it would come back to us differently. In other words, I go back to my original point, putting forward four items which are only in the non-concurrence area of these four areas, it doesn't seem like a very collaborative and cooperative posture. So maybe if they were presented in the context of concurrence, non-concurrence, or concurrence with comments, I might feel differently.
So
if I could just get a word in.
Okay.
Having just talked to Pete Ron and Greg Slater 2-3 days ago, they are not at all confused about our position.
Correct.
They understand us to be trying to work with them. They're not expecting a vote from us to concur or expecting to hear from us about the areas in which we disagree. They understand perfectly well that we need to express our non-concurrence in order to preserve our rights. But they are also very clear, and I made this clear to them, as did Carol and Derek, that we are not only happy to work with them, but that we are supportive of trying to help them figure out a way to get a project that both counties can support.
Very
so
good.
I don't think it's not as though there's any confusion on their side, or they're going to interpret this as something other than an attempt to narrow the issues.
Correct.
Where we need to continue to have discussions, not a broad-based set of comments about what we think of the project in general. They're looking for us to narrow down the things where we just can't get behind continuing with the project unless they're included.
Thank you. And this
right.
is and
right. I the want, other I want the other
stop,
items.
Ms. Rubin, I want to elaborate on that. I agree, and not only with the meeting that you just had, Vice Chair Anderson, but we've had our folks. They're absolutely clear. They've met with the Prince George's County Council. They've met with us. They've met with our Derek Bellage and Deborah Borden and Crystal Hancock repeatedly on these issues and others. So they know those issues that we're in agreement. And we have been briefed on this over and over again here at the Planning Board and at full commission. So, and they have been briefed, and so they know, and we are expected to put forth, as Commissioner, as Vice Chair Anderson just said, those areas of nonconformance. So they do know, and we also have Public Works, the Department of Public Works in Prince George's County. I'm sure you have the same in Montgomery County. Vic Weisberg is here today, and also we've worked with the director of the Department of Public Works, and they have been involved. So we're all putting forth, they know where we are in agreement. They know where we concur, or they know where there are no issues, but we have to set forth these issues of non-concurrence, and that's what we are required to do. I know, now, someone over there, was that Mr. Dreyfus? Mr. Dreyfus? Someone over there was about, oh no, Ms. Rubin.
Actually,
it was
Carol. I was just simply going to indicate that we are having ongoing meetings with State Highway Administration staff. For example, some of the items, just to be clear, to clarify for Commissioner Washington, that some of the items that we are in, you know, we don't agree with, but we are not concurring on. We know that we can move forward. For example, the access points. We had a three-hour meeting with staff. They're relooking at all of the access points that they have put into the project. We were talking about pedestrian and bicycle movement. That's one that's going to be scheduled. So there are things that we have commented on that we're working on because we know they can be resolved with the alternatives that are on the table. The problem that we're – the concurrence, the non-concurrence is we don't think the package is complete.
Are there any other questions on that side? Are there questions or comments on the side? Okay.
Yeah, this is Commissioner Dorner. So I'm definitely appreciative of the staff's analyses that we've done so far and all the hours that have been put into the project. I'm going to reiterate a comment that I made a month ago at the commission that I don't think we're sending the right message in how we're necessarily communicating this. And I like Casey's paraphrasing of our perspective of how we might sort of represent ourselves as not liking everything from a technical non-concurrent standpoint. And I think that needs to be carefully worded, because the summary right now as I read it, I would side with Commissioner Dreyfus in saying that it does not, the summary does not clearly at all in any way convey that this is from a technical standpoint that we're making these objections. It strikes me more as a political or philosophical approach in some ways. And I'm a little bit concerned with that because I don't know the right phasing and when this stuff is going to happen, but my guess is that we're going to have opportunities to address some of these issues. I am concerned that we don't want the ball to kind of get going and then us not be able to make any of these comments. But I do want us to raise questions about, can we get on the managed lanes transit group? There's a working group on that. There's a couple other things that I think we can insert ourselves and add our experts in there. And we should certainly raise those questions with the secretary and make sure our experts are in there. I just want to make sure that if the vote is for this letter to say a non-concurrence, that it is extremely specific. This is from a technical standpoint, because there's some technical details that we're concerned about. And it's the phasing, it's some of the termini in terms of the entry and exit points. I don't think that at all is going to become, that will be a surprise at all to SHA or the others working on these projects. But I want us to be really careful in terms of how we're messaging this, because I'm still not getting the impression that it's being messaged from a sort of a partial standpoint that here's our expert advice and everything. I've seen a lot, I've been reading a lot locally and seeing some of the testimony, and this is becoming almost like a political or philosophical debate, and I fear that in doing that, we're going to lose our ability to make really good pointed comments. And I just want us to be kind of careful in terms of how we do that. So if the summary is written in a more in a slightly different way, I think that would be okay, particularly how Casey had phrased it, because I think that was what my view is, but I hadn't heard that up to this point in this conversation.
Well, I would be happy to write something with the staff's help to express that, and I would have anticipated that if we're going to write a letter for our chair's signatures, that it would include that as like a prefatory. You know.
So, just for the record, Adrian Gardner again, we are going to prepare the letter for the whatever letter the commissioners decide on for transmittal to the Department of Transportation. And I think what I heard Vice Chairman Anderson suggest is that it include language to convey the point that Commissioner Dorner was making about this being our technical non-concurrence, but that we're not expressing an objection to the project or the delivery method that the state has proposed as a fundamental matter. That our and I don't see any problem with that. I mean, I would say that part of the problem or part of the challenge that we're faced with is that the state is being extraordinarily technical. You have to appreciate the fact that the process in this case is a little bit different than usual, which is fine. But if we're in the microwave, we need to make, if we're building this project in a microwave, we're going to have to be very clear about what position we are taking.
Okay. So, essentially, excuse me.
I thought Manny.
Okay, you have to come over here. While Commissioner Giraldo is coming over, sir, you're saying that we can take these same issues, have some prefatory remarks, and make it more palatable. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, using the yeah. Because I certainly appreciated Casey's. This is Commissioner Washington. Casey's comments, which allayed, you know, at least some of my concerns. So.
Okay, Commissioner Giraldo.
Yes. Obviously, I don't have any problem with some prefatory comments, but I believe all of these things have been proposed to the state on more than one occasion. These are issues that we presented before, and it seems that up to this point, they've ignored it. I mean, the biggest one that I'm looking at, it is absolutely ridiculous, but as Chair Lady Hewlett said, is that you're going to stop the toll lane at Branch Avenue when you have 6 miles down the road, you have the MGM. Yeah, makes no sense. Absolutely no sense. Mm-hmm. And it makes no sense as well that you don't have, and I know Mr. Garner said earlier that it doesn't include everything, but I'm sure it'll come up, that they don't have an exit at the new hospital. These are things that common sense dictates.
Which are the same concerns that Prince George's County has been raising. Prince George's County government, Prince George's County executive. We have, I mentioned before, we have Vic Weisberg from Department of Public Works here, but we had Terry Bellamy from the Department of Park Public Works. And we have all had countless meetings on this, and they have taken, the council and the executive expressed their same concerns. Okay. I know, Ms. Commissioner Dorner, you had a question?
No.
No?
I have a question. This is Natalie.
Okay.
Actually, it's a comment. This is a technical document. I will oppose having on that letter saying that we are for or against this project. We don't need to go there. We don't need to reference that at all. So you want to be nice? This is not about being polite. This is about telling them, because they've been working on this almost daily. We don't see it because we only meet once a month, but the staff knows them. So the only thing that we need to say is what we disagree on, and that's it. I am not going to agree with having a letter saying that we oppose or not this project.
Hold on a second, Ms. Fanny Gonzalez. We had a question over here. It does not say that now, but there was some indication that we could put some prefatory language there to say that we,
I didn't understand. This is Commissioner Watt. I didn't understand Vice Chair Anderson's comments to be consistent with supporting or opposing, unless I misunderstood you, Casey. I mean, it was really about putting in context. You know, our posture, role, and wanting to be a strong collaborator as part of the process, that's different than supporting or opposing. Because it means wherever we end up, yes. we want to make sure that we've got an equal seat at the table.
That I agree with.
Yeah, just to be clear, the implication of sending a letter of non-concurrence is not that we fold our arms and hold our breath until we turn blue. The implication is we go into a mediation process, which we try to work out our differences over the alternatives, and that's a very narrow set of issues, just the alternatives analysis, and try to reach concurrence. So we're not saying no to the project, we're not saying yes to the project, we're saying we have these issues with the alternatives that you are proposing to put forward for further study, and we need to come to terms on those. That's it.
Okay, Vice Chair Anderson, I understand Ms. Founding Gonzalez's points, because somebody did say that. I don't think it was you. It might have been, I don't know, somebody said that. So if that's what we're going to put in there, I don't have a problem with it. I think I heard Commissioner Founding Gonzalez say the same thing. Is that correct? Hello? Hello?
We're here, Madam Chair.
Okay, we lost you. Okay, Ms. Commissioner Founding Gonzalez, if it does, as just now explained by Commissioner Anderson, you're okay with that?
Yes, I was okay with that. I just want to make sure what I said.
Got it.
We're good. Moving on.
I just want to make sure we have that on the record. Okay. Okay, so are there other questions on the Montgomery County side? Okay, are there questions or comments on the Prince George's County side? Is there a motion? Or Ms. Rubin, did you have anything else to add?
I just would summarize it in saying that, as Carol Rubin, is that it's not about agreeing or disagreeing with the project. It's about our role and responsibility is to make sure that the environmental impact statement is complete.
Agree. Is there a motion? Do I need to say a motion on this?
No. Yeah, I'm asking for, I wanted her to finish, but I am asking for a motion.
To reframe the motion, I think that the staff recommendation is to authorize the chair and the vice chair to transmit a letter of non-concurrence to the state Maryland Department of Transportation for the reasons expressed in this handout, modified by the explanation that we are continuing to work with them as the process and through the mediation and as the process goes forward.
So move. This is Natalie.
Second.
We have a motion by Commissioner Fannie Gonzalez, seconded by Commissioner Manny Giraldo. Is there any additional discussion? Under discussion, I would thank everybody for their hard work. I know it's not been
Patterson.
Easy.
Hold on, Tina.
Sorry, Madam Chair. I do have one item that I want to just make sure that we will have opportunity to provide further clarification regarding item number two as we move forward. The overall letter, but specifically, we'll be able to go back and talk about the termini. I've heard from both counties that there's concern.
Yes.
Okay, excellent. I'm good.
Okay.
Thank you.
Is there additional discussion? I was just thanking everybody for their hard work. I know we're going to continue because there have been countless meetings and briefings, and we thank you for that. All in favor of the motion indicate by saying aye.
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 Opposed? It's unanimous on this end.
Opposed. Norman.
Okay. One. Okay. So it's one opposed. Okay. Okay. All right. If that's it, we can close the. Is there anything else? So we can. If not, we can. The meeting of the Maryland National Capital Park and Planning Commission is now adjourned. Or is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Okay.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor, indicate by saying aye.
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 Opposed. The ayes have it. Thank you very much. The Maryland National Capital Park and Planning Commission meeting is now over. We are terminating. Thanks.
Okay.
Prince George's County Planning Board is back in session. Mr. Hunt, is there any additional business to come before? Well, Mr. Hunt's not here. Okay. Mr. Berlage, is there any additional business to come before the Prince George's County Planning Board at this time?
No, there is not, Madam Chair.
Okay. Planning Board is adjourned.